Good evening, everyone. Choir, thank you so much for that song. I tell you, God has blessed Filipinos with some singing gifts. You have a really great musical talent. I think all the choirs in heaven is going to be Filipinos. You guys are sounding really, really great. I am always enjoying the musical selections that you are providing for us. Thank you. And how are you guys doing tonight? Good? Today I had an opportunity to visit CPAC. C-P-A-C. It's a college way out there in the jungle. And I had to fight through the monkeys. I'm just kidding you. But it was a great campus, nice young people. I had a little time with them today, talking to them about how God used me, even though I was so dumb and lazy. But if God can use me, then God can use those young people, amen? And then on the way back, we stopped by the sanitarium, or not sanitarium, the hospital. And I had the opportunity to grab some food, Filipino food. And I grabbed this bag of, I have no idea what to call them. They look round, completely flat. And when you bite into it, you have this reddish, dark brown stuff. What did I eat? Huh? Piaya. I like piaya. That was namit. I tell you, that was really delicious. That's all I had for my supper. I don't like to eat that much for supper, but I mean, that was a really, really delicious. And thank you for whoever invented that, God bless you. All right, so you guys ready for tonight's study? You guys ready? Okay. Now, last night we talked about, you know, seven churches, message to seven churches. Tonight we're going to focus on one particular church and one particular message. Because for me, this message has got to be one of those messages that are really, really important. All right? So we're looking at the church Laodiceans. Now, it is very interesting how those names, you remember last night we talked about the different names like Ephesus, Smyrna, Pergamos, Thyatira, Sardis, Philadelphia, and Laodicea. It is very interesting. Now, first of all, Laodicea is the last day, describing the condition of the last day church. Okay? So we're living, at this time, we're living what we call the period of Laodicea. Now, what is interesting is this. The word Laodicea, if you do a Greek search to find out the meaning behind it, Laodicea just simply means people that are being judged. People being judged. So church Laodicea just simply means it's a time when God's people are going to be judged. So in the message, there are a lot of messages regarding judgment. In fact, last night we learned that Jesus is really telling us to experience righteousness by faith. In fact, you know, we have no chance to stand before God's judgment. It doesn't matter how well you live from now and onward, just you standing on your own with your own goodness, we have no chance. And that is the reason why we need to receive righteousness of Jesus in order to pass through the judgment. However, there is a deeper issue, deeper meaning, deeper experience than the Bible is trying to tell us that we should have. So tonight, I call it the knock of judgment. Because here we have, in Revelation chapter 3, verse 20. And this verse is given towards the end of the Laodicean message. It's like the final saying. It's like the final appeal to the final church. The last appeal. It's got to be really important. And the Bible says, "Behold, I stand at the door," and what? "Knock. If any man hear my voice and open the door, I will come in to him and will sup with him and he with me." Believe it or not, that's all we're going to study tonight. However, in order for us to understand this text, we have to take a journey to the book of Matthew, chapter 24 and 25. And we will be there for a while, and then we will come back to this text so that you understand the bigger picture of what this is saying. I know many of you read this verse before, and I'm sure the way you used it was something like, why don't you have Jesus come into your heart, right? Jesus is knocking on your heart. Just open your heart and let Jesus come in. That's how you understand it, yes? And that understanding, not bad, pretty good. But tonight, we are going to go deeper. The true meaning behind it. Would you like to understand the secrets in the book of Revelation? Yes, that's what we're going to do. So, let's take a journey to book of Matthew, chapter 24. And there you go, Matthew chapter 24 and 25. I have decided to, copy and paste the entire chapter of 24 and entire chapter of 25. All right, ladies and gentlemen, let's read. All right, that was really quick. That was fast reading. Now, I know that's a lot of information there, right? There's so many things to read about. So what I did is that I outlined it, meaning organized it for you, okay? And let me show you what we have in there. It looks like a lot, but you can divide that the whole passage into three sessions or sections, okay? Three sections, all right? Here we go. So part one, really, Matthew chapter 24, verse 3 to 29. Now, I skipped verse 1 and 2 because that's when, when the disciples came to Jesus asking some questions. But anyhow, Matthew chapter 24, verse 3 to 29, those verses are really, according to the Bible, talking about the signs of time. And you understand signs of time. We talked about it a little bit the other day. False Christ, rumors of war, nations are against nation, pestilences, famine, earthquake, persecution, great tribulation, sun turning dark. We're going to talk about that a few nights from now. And the moon turning into blood and the stars are falling. Yeah, these are the signs of the end time, the final days. So those verses, all right, verses 3 to 29, we call them signs of time. All right. And the next portion is even smaller portion. It's only that much. Only a few verses. Verses 30 to 42. Basically, 13 verses. Basically talking about the second coming. How he will come with all the holy angels. How the angels will come with the great sounding of trumpet. How all eyes shall see him. How it will be in the days like the days of Noah, how one will be taken, one left. It's a description of the second coming of Jesus in those verses. If you'd like to do another comparison, very simple. The first part, the signs of time, all right? War, pestilences, earthquake, persecution, all right? False Christ, false prophets, or false Christ, false prophets using signs and wonders and miracles to deceive people. All these things, you can say, acts of Satan, okay? The acts of Satan. And then the following portion, smaller portion, it is about second coming. So you can say the act of Jesus. You with me? Is that simple? Yeah? So first part, all the acts of Satan, and then acts of Jesus. He is coming. And then we're left with the rest of chapter 24 and the entire chapter of 25. And believe it or not, we can group all of them into one. We call it, or may I call it, the four parables. What did I say? Four parables, yes. Four parables are mentioned in Matthew chapter 24, verse 43, and then entire chapter of 25. And parables, now, do you remember reading those parables? You don't remember? If you read them, they all have this one common denominator, and that is this. All parables are something about followers of God. All those parables are something about those that believe in God, worship God. In fact, we did talk about one parable last night, right? Or two nights ago. So what we have here, let's put it really simple. All the parables, okay, the first part is describing what Satan will do in the last days. The second part is describing what Christ will do at the second coming of Christ, okay? And the last part is describing what the church will do in the last days. So the last part is about church members. It's all about church members. So in the four parables, you have, listen, in the four parables, you have a clue to know how to get ready for a second coming. So what do you know about the signs of time? So what do you know about the works of Satan? So what do you know about the second coming and how all the angels will come with him? So what do you know about that it will be in the days or like the days of Noah? So what? Who cares? If you are not ready, those knowledge cannot save you. So, ladies and gentlemen, may I ask you a dumb question? Okay. So when Jesus talked about the last days in chapter 24 and 25, which topic did Jesus talk about the most? What Satan will do, what he will do, or what the church will do? Yeah, he talked about much more about the church. Why? Because it's got to be what? It's more important than other stuff. Not that other stuff are not important. They are important. But listen, pay attention. Whenever God talks a lot more about certain topic, more than some other topic, God is trying to say, pay more attention to this. Are you with me? Isn't that the way you communicate? Yes or no? Yes? Children, young people, when you talk to your parents, you want something. That's all you talk about all day, yes or no? Right? Yeah, exactly. The Bible is the same way, all right? Let me give you some other examples. You guys ready? Do you remember Genesis chapter 1? Yeah? It speaks about the creation. First day, what God created, and the second day, third day. Now, which day do you think we have the most information out of 6 days? Now, I know 1 week is, 7 days, but not including seventh day, because seventh day is not mentioned in chapter 1. It's mentioned in chapter 2. So in chapter 1, 6 days, which day do you think God talked about the most? Let's find out. First day, that much. Second day, that much. Third day, that much. Oh, it's getting more. Fourth day, that much. Fifth day, that much. And the sixth day, that much. Now, I have to tell you, that the reason why it's so long, because, let me read. Oh, no. Yeah, that's what it is. Yeah. So can you see God spent a lot more time talking about the sixth day? Yes? Say yes. What does that mean? It's more important. Why? Because you are created. You understand? God loves you. God wants to talk more about you. Do you feel special? Say yes. Amen. Okay. Now are you getting this? Yeah? Let me give you one more example. Ten Commandments. All Ten Commandments are important. It doesn't matter which one. Short one, long one, it doesn't matter. Every one of them are important. However, why is it that the second commandment and the fourth commandment so much description? Why? How many of you, any mommy and daddy here tonight, do you ever wish that the fifth commandment is the longest one? Thou shalt honor thy parents. Make sure you study well. Make sure you go to a good college and get a good job. And make sure you give your parents allowances and money and hug and kisses every day. How many of you like to extend and edit the fifth commandment, make the longest one? Yeah? Are you getting my point? Now, all of them are important, but notice God gave more information about the second and the fourth. Why? God is saying pay what? More attention. Because people are going to easily forget the second commandment and the fourth commandment. And that's the reason why, my friends, the world is filled with idol worship and the world is filled with forgetting God's Sabbath. Yeah? So God knows what He's doing. So pay attention to when God gives you a lot more information. So, ladies and gentlemen, make your choice. If we have to pay attention to one section, which one should we study tonight? Yeah, you're exactly right. The four parables. That's exactly what we're going to do. All right. The four parables. May I remind you what those are? Four parables. Number one, the first parable is about the wise and an evil servant. And we talked about that a few nights ago. And then the second parable, the Bible says the wise and foolish virgins. Notice there's always two groups, right? In fact, it begins with one group, but then they become two. They get separated. Another one, parable number three, the faithful and unprofitable servant. Okay, I should have wrote servant, not servants. But anyhow, the faithful and unprofitable servant. And sometimes we call that the parable of talents. And then the last parable, the sheep and the goats. All right, so here we have the four parables. Just to give you a little description, you remember the first one, the wise and the evil servant? The wise one was giving meat in due season. Evil servant was drinking with the drunken and beating up the other servants. You remember that? How the Lord came and separated them and God punished the evil servant and honor the wise one. And do you remember the parable of the 10 virgins? Sometimes we call it the 10 virgins, 5 wise, 5 foolish. You remember the story how they were all waiting for the bridegroom to come, but then there was a delay, and because of the delay, they all fell asleep. But then at midnight, they heard the cry, "Bridegroom is coming." And so they all woke up and they're trimming their lamp and they got their lamps ready. But then only the 5 wise ones had extra oil. They had extra what? Extra oil. And the foolish ones, no extra oil. Why they did not take the extra oil? Because they were predicting that the bridegroom should come before their oil runs out. I call that time setting. Please, ladies and gentlemen, do not time set the second coming of Jesus. Don't say He is coming at a such and such a time. Don't do that. You will become like those foolish virgins. You should always have extra oil. so that you are ready at any time. Amen? So that was the second parable. And the third parable, you remember how Master, before he went on a long journey, he gave talents to his servants. And then when he came back, he asked to see what they have done with the talents. The servant that received two got double. The servant that received five got double. But the servant that received only one talent, he was so afraid that he hid the talent. And then when the master asked for what to do with the talent, he just simply said, "Here's your one talent that you gave me. How come you didn't use it? I was afraid you're going to spank me. What if I lose the talent? At least I got your talent back." But then he was considered by the master unprofitable and wicked as well, and he was cast out. And you remember what happened to just going back to the foolish virgins, because they didn't have the oil. They weren't able to go into the wedding. Because of that, they were cast out. And then the final parable, the parable of the sheep and the goats. This is talking about how when Jesus will come back with all holy angels, he will gather all the nations and then he will divide the sheep on the right and the goats on his left. And then why is there separation? Why is there separation? The separation is based upon sheep. He said, "When I was hungry, when I was thirsty, when I was sick, when I was naked, you helped me." To the sheep. To the goats, "When I was hungry, when I was naked, when I was thirsty, when I was sick, you did not help me." Very interesting way to divide the sheep and the goats. So these are the parables that we're going to look a little more into tonight, in order for us to understand Revelation chapter 3, verse 20, regarding Jesus knocking. So then, observe with me. See these parables? They look like four different parables, but, ladies and gentlemen, it's not really four parables. It's really one parable that has four stages. It is showing how things are going to be, may I say, really hard for us to judge. But God can judge. Let me explain to you. Let me explain. Check this out. You'll get this. Okay? Everybody breathe in. I need your brain to work tonight, okay? Breathe in and breathe out. All right, here we go. Now, notice the first parable. Just watch. Wise servant and evil servant. Completely what? Opposite expression. Yes or no? Wise, that's positively good. Okay? Evil, that's definitely what? Bad. See? So in the beginning of the parable, even other people can easily, what? Judge which is good, which is bad. Yes or no? Based upon the description. But then when you go to the next parable, it's getting hard to distinguish who is good, who is bad. Let me explain. The second parable is wise and foolish virgins. Okay? Yes, yes, yes. There's a distinction between wise and foolish. There is that distinction, but it's wise virgins, foolish virgins. The Bible does not say wise virgins and foolish harlots. You understand? Meaning, they're all what? Virgins, representing they all have purity. Whoa, wait a minute. You can have purity, but yet foolish and not be saved? Are you hearing? You can still have some pure characteristic about yourself, but you're still considered foolish and not saved, right? So if you think about it, ladies and gentlemen, the Bible just simply saying that you may have pure doctrine, but if you don't have that extra oil, you are a foolish virgin. And we're going to talk a little more about that a little bit later. But the distinction is getting not so clear, right? And then the third parable. Third parable, only at the end of the story of the third parable, the master says you are faithful and you are unprofitable. But in the beginning of the parable, the master just simply, or the Bible simply says, three servants. In fact, I can call the third parable three servants, because only at the end they were distinguished. In the beginning of the parable, they're just called three servants. It is as though no distinction. You with me? And then the final parable, sheep and the what? Goats. The Bible does not say sheep and the dogs, sheep and the pigs, sheep and the wolf. You with me? You understand? Sheep and goats both are vegetarians. Yes or no? And both of them are in the sanctuary. In Jewish people, they use sheep and goats for holy purpose. Distinction is, it's like it's not there. It's not there. Right? When you say servants, that's a little more neutral. But when you say sheep and goats, in the eyes of Jewish people, both are good. But yet, only one will be saved. So, what are these parables trying to say? As we get closer and closer, closer to the end time, it's going to be hard for you and me to distinguish who is ready, who is not ready. You don't know. Because the judgment is something that only God can do. Say amen. So you have to make sure that you're right before God. No time to play around. In fact, all these four parables, they have one thing in common, repeating itself. And you already understand how I like to look for things that are repeating, repeating, repeating. Why? Because that's the emphasis. So pay attention to repetition. And when you study these four parables, they all have one thing in common. You know what that is? Separation. Separation. Why? In the beginning of the parables, they start together. But at the end, boom, separated. Together in the beginning, at the end, boom, separated. And then the final parable, the Bible says, he will separate sheep and the goats. So what is separation? Now, let me take you to a Bible text in Book of Revelation, chapter 14, verse 7, the Bible says, this is talking about the end time gospel message, the everlasting gospel that were given to all the world before Jesus come. And all the world should know about this message, and that is, it says, saying with a loud voice, fear God and give glory to him, for the what? Hour of his what? Judgment is come. And that word judgment, ladies and gentlemen, pay attention, that word judgment in original Greek language, the word judgment means, it pronounces krisis, krisis. Now, the word krisis in Greek sounds like crisis. Yes, yes or no? Yeah? In fact, if you look up the word crisis in English, the root word goes back to krisis, the word for judgment in Greek. Why? Because it is at a a time of crisis, your true character will be revealed. It's not when things are peaceful and calm, you will show your character. No. True character usually comes out when things go wrong. So I used to tell young ladies how to find a right husband. How do you know their character? Don't listen to them when they're all sweet talking to you. 95% they're lying to you. Even though they might be lying to you, they're just sincerely deceived. Whatever they say, okay? But if you want to know guy's true character, what you need to do, go for a hike in a big group. But when you go for a hike, go up to a mountain where there are lots of rocks. And when you go for a walk, you hope that that guy will trip and fall. Like he will trip and fall and have a little crisis. And then when he trips and falls, listen to very carefully what words will come out of his mouth next. If he says, you know, really ugly, that's not the right one. Then come down from the mountain without him. Okay? If he's like, it's painful, but God is good. If he says things like that, then he might be the right one. He might be the right one. Okay? Okay, that's how, crisis will reveal true character, right? So very interesting, the word judgment in Greek, krisis, but look at this, the word krisis, okay, the definition, decision, judgment, and look at this, a separating, sunder, separation. So what is judgment? Separation. Why? When you're judging, you're saying good and bad. You are separating good and bad. You see? That's what it is, judgment. So therefore, when four parables, they all repeating the same thing. What is it? Separation, separation, separation. What does that mean? They're all going through judgment. Exactly. So what is God trying to say? He is saying, look, here are the signs of time. Just to let you know how soon my coming is. And then when I come, this is the way I'm coming. So you can identify who I am. However, I need you to be ready for the judgment. And this is a way that you will be judged. So study four parables carefully so that you know exactly how to get ready for his coming. Is that clear? Is everything clear? All right, then we move on. So then, when we consider these parables, let's make it really simple. Let's not get all complicated, ladies and gentlemen, because you just have to make sure that you have all the characteristics of the good guys and you don't have all the characteristics of the bad guys. You with me? As long as you have all the characteristics of the good guy, you should be okay. Yeah? So let's find out all the good characteristics of the good guys. So let's not even talk about the bad guys. All right. So then we have four parables just looking at the good people. And what are the major characteristics of each person or each group of people that the parable is trying to say? The first one, give them meat in due season. Now, we studied this before, and we learned that meat in the Bible represents the Word of God, or we call that the what? The truth, right? Sanctify them through thy word, for thy word is truth, right? So give them meat in due season. This means they know the truth and they know how to deliver the truth to other people. So then, in order to be ready for the coming of Christ, we have to have the truth. The truth. However, that is not enough. Just because you have the truth, that is not enough. That is the reason why we have the second parable. With 10 virgins. Virgins, meaning pure. What does that mean? They have the pure truth. But only 5 saved. So then, what else do you need besides the truth? According to the Bible, the parable says the wise took oil in their what? In their vessels, and the foolish one, they did not take any oil. Let's consider this. First of all, listen carefully. Imagine all 10 virgins. They all have lamps. Okay? And they all have oil in the lamps. But the wise ones, they have extra oil in their vessels as well. Pay attention. According to the Bible, lamps represents Word of God. Because in Book of Psalms, it says, "Thy word is a lamp unto my feet." Yeah? So a lamp itself represents the Word of God or the truth. So 10 virgins, they all have lamp, meaning they all have the what? Truth, exactly. And according to the Bible, oil represents Holy Spirit. All right? Based upon Zechariah. All right? So you got the lamp, the truth, and the oil, what? Holy Spirit. So you gotta have truth and the Spirit. Now, question, listen. In order for you to give light, okay, you have to have the lamp and oil. Can you give light with just one? Can you give light with just an empty lamp? Can you give light if you just have the oil? You gotta have what? Both of them, exactly. Some people, they don't have the Holy Spirit. When we say Holy Spirit, what are we talking about? We're talking about the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, long-suffering, kindness, goodness, yeah? So we as a Christian, when we follow the truth, we have to allow the Holy Spirit to change us so that our character will become sweet as a sweet Spirit of Christ. But some people, they don't have that character transformation. What do they have? The truth. It's like only have the lamp. And they're trying to show people the light with empty lamp. And they go, "See? Can you see the light? Come on, see the light." And then they use a lamp to hit the person's head. Boom. And they don't see light, they see stars. Do you understand what I'm talking about? So you cannot give light just with the truth. But then the other extreme, some people, some Christians, they don't really care about the truth. They don't really care about the doctrine. They just keep playing down. Doctrine not important. Truth not important. Don't worry about these kind of things. Let's just worry about filled with the Holy Spirit. So they just keep preaching about Holy Spirit, the oil, the outpouring, the Holy Spirit, the Pentecost, the Holy. Listen, can you give light just with the oil? Yeah? Can you imagine just having oil? What kind of people are you? You are oily people. You have no structure, no foundation. You have no clear guidance. There's nothing to hold you. You just have this emotional, like oily emotional Christian experience. Yeah, goes up, slip down. Listen, don't become like that, okay? Some people, they go to church like a psychology treatment. Just go there to sing some songs and jump up and down, make sure they feel good and then go home. Yeah, no, religion is, I mean, yes, you can feel good with Jesus, amen, but the Bible is a lot more profound than just having good emotions, ladies and gentlemen. It gives you piercing understanding of what the reality is and gives you enlightenment that is beyond just feeling happy. We gotta believe that the Bible is much more. So that's the reason why when Jesus was talking to the woman at the well, you remember the story? Jesus met with the woman at the well. The woman is like, oh, our father said we should worship in this mountain. Your people say we should worship that mountain. Where should we worship? And Jesus said, it doesn't matter. But you gotta worship God in the spirit and in truth. Spirit and in truth. Right there. Spirit and in truth. Don't separate them. You get yourself in trouble. So don't try to shine the light with just one. Have both of them. And that is the reason why we have the second parable. What's important? Oil. But what is interesting, that oil was in where? In the vessels. According to the Bible, you see, lamp is the truth, right? But vessels, 2 Corinthians chapter 4, verse 6 and 7, the vessels represents us. So some people have the Holy Spirit maybe for understanding the truth, but they may not have the Holy Spirit in the vessel, earthen vessel, right here. So that's how you need to get your oil inside of you, according to Romans chapter 5. It speaks of how Holy Spirit will be shed upon you to imbue you with the love of God. So then how do you get the Holy Spirit? How? I'm sure you know. Just ask. Ask for the Holy Spirit. Okay, that's fine. But let me give you a deeper understanding. Long time ago, let me put it this way. Long time ago, how did they get oil? How did they get oil? They have to what? Press. They take oil, olives, and they have to press them. You know how you get your Holy Spirit? You have to allow God, listen, you have to allow God to press you down until you become nothing. That's how you fill yourself with the Holy Spirit. If you come to God with your own idea, your opinion, your own personality, your own traits of characteristics and who you are, you're so tough and mean and you're just observing yourself and you don't want to change at all, right? It's like, nothing can crush me, that kind of attitude. You cannot receive the Holy Spirit. You have to say, something's wrong with me. I have to change. I gotta change. I need a new life. I need a new character. God, please help me. You gotta become meek and humble. You understand? You have to be pressed down. Don't you remember Jesus in Gethsemane? And the word Gethsemane is pressing. That's what it means, Gethsemane, pressed down. And it was at that point Jesus made a decision. I mean, he made a decision way before, but he reconfirmed it. How? If it's possible, let this cup pass from me. But not my will, but your will be done. Not my will, but your will be done. Three times, not my will, but your will be done. That's pressing experience. I become nothing so that God will become everything in my life. When you have that kind of dedication and prayer and devotion and consecration to God, then God can fill you, your soul, with the Holy Spirit. You have to go through that process. Not my will, but you will be done. Not my will, but you will be done. So these wise virgins, that's what they had. The foolish ones, no, nothing in their vessels. They just like the truth. Because truth can be exciting. Oh, truth can be, make you feel powerful. I know something you don't know. I know you're doing something not right because I know. Some people are like this. Let me point out what's wrong with you. Some people are like that. So they're in the church, but they're so judgmental. Yeah, we're all no good. Terrible. Yeah, if you ask them to
Can you love them?
No. They cannot really express love because they're so judgmental. But then you have the other people, they love everybody, again, greasy, oily people. So then, is it clear to you? You gotta have the truth, but you have to have what? Holy Spirit, exactly, exactly. If you have the truth, if you have the Holy Spirit, ladies and gentlemen, you are ready for heaven. Say amen. But so then, how many of you know that you have the Holy Spirit and the truth? Would you like to know how you can know? Would you like to know how you can know? Okay, that's the reason why we have the next parable. That is the exact reason why. How do you know you have the truth? How do you know you have the Holy Spirit? Based upon next parable, it says the master, before he went for a long journey, he gave talents to his servants. One servant, one talent. Second servant, two talents. Third servant, five talents. By the way, do you ever like read that parable and you feel like, how come Jesus only gives one talent and then five talent? And do you ever like, I want five? You greedy people. Have you ever had a little desire? Yes? Come on. Maybe? Listen, ladies and gentlemen, let me tell you something. It's better that you receive only one talent. You know why? More talents you receive, guess what? More responsibility you have. So if you only have one talent, say thank God. And just be faithful with that one talent, okay? It doesn't matter if I have five or 100 talents, as long as I'm using the talent that God has given me, okay? So then, why is that parable there? Very simple. How do you know you have the Holy Spirit and the truth? This is a sign. If you use your talent for God, if you use your talents for God, then that's how you can test to see you have the truth or not. There are a lot of people, they're just like, they don't do much. They just come to church and receive the truth, maybe have some good Holy Spirit experience, but then it doesn't translate into using their talents. Now you're probably thinking, what talents are you talking about? Listen, in the Bible, okay, when we talk about the work of the Holy Spirit and giving talents, giving different responsibility in the church, it sounds basically like talent is a speech. Talent is an influence. Talent is money. Talent is time. Okay? These are the talents. Talent is an intellect. So then, do you have these talents? Yes or no? You do. Even if you only have 2 pesos, you got a talent of money. Yes? You have all these talents. The question is, are you using them for God? If you truly have the Holy Spirit, if you truly have the truth, if they're really working in you, okay, it should come out in such a way that you are using your talent for God. If you are one of these people, keep hearing the truth, but you're not using the talent for God, it might be a good sign that you are not having Holy Spirit experience. You may ask the question, does that mean we cannot work? We have to make money and support ourselves. Yes, the Bible says, yeah, work 6 days, rest on the seventh day Sabbath, right? So it's okay to work, no problem. You can survive, get a nice car, get a nice house, no problem, absolutely no problem. But here's the thing, God understands that you have to survive, but if all you're doing is to survive, you are not really using your talents. I'm talking about, just few hours here and few hours there, time opportunity here and opportunity over there, a time that when you can use your talent for the work of God. If you don't do that, you're just like those fishermen's club. Have you heard about this fishermen's club? You have all these people, they gather together for a fishermen's club. And they have to pay lots of money to be in that club. When they come together, they talk about the fish. They talk about the freshwater fish. They talk about the seawater fish. They talk about seasonal fish. They talk about the bait. They talk about the rod. They talk about the string. They talk about the ship. They talk about different weather patterns. They talk about everything about fish. But they never fish. They even sing a song about fish. They read magazines about fish. They read books about fish. They even watch videos about fish, but they never go fish. I believe 90% of the Christians are like that. Yes or no? Yeah? Huh. Are you understanding these parables now better? Yeah? Do you have the truth? I do. Do you have the Holy Spirit? I think so. How are you using your talents? Are you using those talents? Because, ladies and gentlemen, if the Spirit, if the truth is in you, that means Jesus. If the Spirit is in you, that is the love of God. If Jesus and the love of God is in you, you are going to act like Jesus. Always ready for the mission for God. It's not about, I'm always planning my future, my retirement, my job, my school, so I can get my car, my clothes, and my computer, my iPhone, and all these things. I know. I like to buy a car and house, and I like to buy, you know, gadgets and electronic stuff. Yeah, I get enjoyment. But ladies and gentlemen, there's a higher enjoyment, higher pleasure that God is saying, come, apply yourself to that. Are you hearing? Are you having that kind of experience? All right then. So the third parable is about talents. How are you using your talents? Now you're asking a question. Okay. So then we use our talents for God's work. But how should we use God? How should we use it for God's work? In what way? Ladies and gentlemen, and that is the reason why we have the parable number 4. The parable number 4 says, all right, this is how you need to use the talents. And if you do it this way, that is the ultimate sign that says, you have the truth, you have the Spirit. And what is that talking about? It says, inasmuch as ye have done it unto the what? One of the least of these, my brethren, ye have done it unto me. Jesus said, sheep stand on my right side, goats on my left. And Jesus said to the sheep, when I was hungry, you fed me. When I was a stranger, you took me in. When I was thirsty, you gave me a drink. When I was sick, you visited me. When I was in prison, you came unto me. And the sheep says, we don't know. Were you hungry, Jesus? Were you naked? Were you thirsty? Were you sick? Were you in prison? And Jesus said, as you have done it unto the least of my brethren, you have done it unto me. When you have done something for other people, you have done it unto me. The final conclusion of a judgment is how much love have you shown to the least of your brethren? I'm keeping Sabbath. Yeah, very good, very good, very good. I'm paying tithes. Yeah, good for you. And most likely you're giving tithes because the Bible says you get more blessing, yeah? Nice business tactic, okay. Yeah, very good, good for you. Yeah. I'm going to church. Yeah, I mean, yeah, how hard is it? How hard is it to go to church? Yeah? Even you go to church in just the last minute, you know, before a pastor does his closing prayer, you were in the church. You know, some people aren't. They come right before pastor has his final prayer. Amen. Potluck time. Yeah? I mean, it's easy. Come on. Don't make it too hard. Yeah? Going to church, just walking in. That's all. It's not that hard. The thing is, if you truly say God is love, if you truly say God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, if you truly say Jesus loved us so much that he sacrificed himself, what have you done to show the love of God to the least of your brethren? It doesn't say the most popular, well-liked, favored people. It says the least of your brethren. And what does that mean? He mentioned what? Hunger, you fed me naked, clothed me thirsty, give me drink. What are all these things? A natural human association, community service. Turned down into, simply, always seeking out to take care those are in need. Now, when you hear this, you're thinking, oh, then let's forget giving Bible study and baptizing people. Let's just give them food, clothing, and take them to hospital for free, and then we go to heaven. If you think that way, again, you are not seeing the big picture. Because, ladies and gentlemen, let me show you something. That's what Jesus said. For I was hungry, you gave me a meat. I was thirsty, you gave me a drink. I was a stranger, you took me in. Naked, it clothed me. I was sick, you visited me. I was in prison, you came unto me. Now, notice what Jesus said. Listen very carefully. Jesus said in Luke chapter 4, verse 18, he was declaring his mission. He was stating why he came. So Jesus said, the Spirit of the Lord is what? Upon me, because he has, next word please, anointed. The word anointed is usually used with what? Oil. See, Holy Spirit, anointed, oil. You see that? Oil came unto me, okay, to what? Preach the gospel to the poor. He has sent me to what? Heal the brokenhearted. To what? Preach deliverance to the captives. And what? Recovering of sight to the blind. To set at liberty them that are what? Bruised, to preach the acceptable ear of the Lord. That's what Jesus said. So the sheep, when they were feeding, giving drink, giving clothing, you know what they were doing? They were doing exactly what Jesus was doing on earth. And when you read the Bible, Jesus, he was teaching mental, he was preaching spiritual, he was healing physical. So, do you have the truth? Good for you. Do you have the Holy Spirit? Perfect. Excellent. What are you using your talents? Are you using it? You don't know how to use it? Use it in the way that you are doing what Jesus was doing on earth. And you don't have to do that full time. You don't have to do that half time. You can do it part time. And some of you say, oh, that's a good thing. I'm too busy making money. No. It doesn't work that way. Your actually full-time job is the mission. Full-time in terms of your heart. Actual hours may not be full-time, but your heart should be in the mission. Your regular work is just to support you. So you can eat some, you can eat some rice, some potatoes, some mushrooms, okay? So some of these food that you can eat and survive and have a house. That's all. It's not, that is not your mission on earth. Your mission on earth is not eat rice. It's not. Your mission on earth is, who needs the love of God shining through my life? Whether it is by verbally talking to them, or literally giving them food, or giving them Bible study, or praying with them, or visiting them, or just to take care of them, just to be with them, so that they have a chance to experience love of God through your presence. Many of us were just thinking about, okay, well, let's go help people, but in your mind, let's go find people to baptize. So you look at the people, you have this watery eyes, not watery eye of tears, of joy, but watery eye of baptism. We want more number in our church. Why? Because more number, more tithe. I know, it all makes sense, logically speaking, but listen, for one second, when you're giving Bible study, it's not about, I gotta make you a church member. No, thank God for giving me opportunity to show love of God to this person. And then truth come out, and then the Spirit comes out. And when that person responds to the Spirit and the truth that you are sharing, guarantee that person will say, I wanna get baptized. You understand? This is what we need, my friends. This is what we need to experience. Look at it. That's exactly what Jesus is saying. Now let's go back to Revelation chapter 3, verse 20. The Bible says, listen carefully, behold, I stand at the door, what? At the door and knock. If any man hear my what? Voice and open the door, I will come in to him and will sup with him and he with me. Now, the final judgment is you open the door. Yes or no? All you have to do, open the door. But listen to the text very carefully. Why is Jesus knocking on the door? Read the Bible text. Why is he knocking? He says, I'm knocking. If you hear my voice, open the door, because I want to come into you and to what? Sup with him. What does that mean, sup? Eat together. Ladies and gentlemen, let me ask you something. Okay? Who should be in charge of feeding? One that is knocking, usually speaking, one that is knocking or one that is in the house? One that is in the house. So when Jesus was knocking, what is he knocking? Open the door and feed me. Jesus said, when I was a stranger, you took me in. When I was hungry, you fed me. So Jesus knocking and crying out, open the door, feed me. And you're like, oh, that is so nice. But how do we listen? How do we hear that knocking? Very simple. Throughout your days, you could have spent just a short minute. You see people in need, emotionally, physically, mentally, spiritually. You see them. When you see them, you're hearing the knock. Let me balance this out, make it practical. Just because you see poor people every day, that does not mean you should help every poor person. Let me make that really clear. Okay? You don't have to help every poor person. Jesus, when he went to places, there are times that he healed everybody, and there are times that he did not heal everybody. Okay? So even in this, practically speaking, you gotta allow the Holy Spirit to guide you. However, the readiness of your willing service, it should be always there, because the truth and the Holy Spirit is working in your heart. So, but then there are times, you know what I'm talking about, there are times you walk around and you see a need. That's the knocking of Jesus upon your door. And when we not listen to that, it is as though we are not opening the door to Jesus. So I don't care how much doctrine we know. I don't care how many years you attended the church. At the end, the ultimate question is, what have you done to the least of your brethren? That's the true judgment of character and the test for the last days. There was a rich young ruler. He has everything. He's rich, he's young, and he's in authority, in power. Man. But yet, he came to Jesus as though something was missing. Good master, what should I do to inherit eternal life? And Jesus said, thou knowest the commandments. Do not commit adultery, do not kill, do not steal, do not bear false witness, honor thy father and thy mother. And the young man said, and he said, all these things have I kept from my youth up. How many of you can say what he said? Wow, this young man, he's got to be pretty spiritual. What do you think? He can say to Jesus, I kept all these things from youth up. I didn't break not even one commandment. By the way, if you keep God's commandment, is that a sure way of going to heaven? It sounds like it, right? This young man says, I kept all the commandments of God. Then Jesus said, yet lackest thou one thing. One thing is lacking. What is it? I kept all the commandments, but one thing is lacking. What is that? Sell all that you have, and what? Distribute unto the poor, and thou shalt have treasure in heaven, and come and follow me. Now, some people here tonight, you're thinking, oh, that's what it is. Okay, honey, we're selling everything. Our motorcycle, our jeepney, they're all going. Our kitchen and our cookware, everything is gone. Everything has to go. No. Come on. Calm down. Listen. Why is Jesus saying you have to sell everything? Okay? It's very simple. Can't you get it? The young man is like, I keep commandments of God. Jesus is like, you lack one thing. Meaning, you are not really keeping God's commandment. What does that mean? If you really keep God's commandment, you should be able to show love and mercy to those who are in need. That's keeping commandments of God. Yes, keeping Sabbath, Saturday, important. Keeping all commandments, important. Not doing, important. However, when you just look at 10 commandments, if you really think about it, 8 of them, don't do. Only 2, do. Yes or no? So 80%, as long as you don't do them, you're fine. So basically, what you need to do, if you go legalistically, all you have to do is just 20%. What are those 20%? Honor your father and mother and remember the Sabbath to keep it holy. If you're honoring father and mother, okay, and keeping the Sabbath and don't do anything, legally speaking, you're keeping 10 commandments. Are you getting my point? Legally speaking, you're keeping 10 commandments. But what Jesus is saying, even though you do that, if you don't have love, you are not keeping God's commandment. Why? Thou shalt not kill. I didn't kill anyone, but did you give life? Thou shalt not steal. I didn't steal anything, but did you help somebody so that that person will not be tempted to steal? Are you getting the point? So don't say, I kept the commandment because I didn't do anything. No, when you go to heaven, if I can tell you in an imagination way, you go to heaven, knock, knock, knock. Heaven, open the door to me. Heaven will say, why should I open the door to you? And you say, I kept all the commandments of God. And heaven will say, you really kept the commandments of God? And you say, yes, I honor my parents and I kept the Sabbath. And I didn't do anything. And the heaven was saying, well, it's not about what you have not done. It's really about what have you done? What have you done for one other humanity in your life? What have you done? One time, I was in a country called Ecuador. You know where that is? Ecuador? Spanish country. I was in this place called Baños. I don't know why they call it Baños. Baños means bathroom. The town is called Baños. I don't know. So I was in the city, and I was doing what we call medical missionary work. Medical missionary work. At a public park, we set up tables, okay? And we have a team of young people, and myself and my wife. And then my wife will do the regular health checkup, and then other people will do other checkup. And then when the people come to my station, I give them chair massage. And then at the end of the chair massage, I invite them to the meeting. You see, good system, right? Free health checkup. Yeah? Health counseling, and then nice massage. And they like my massage. Why? Because I massage in such a way that it looks like kung fu. And those Spanish people, they love my massage. They go, Chino, Chino, muy bueno. Go get massage from him. And I used to have like a 50 people lined up, and they're fighting for the line. I said, don't fight, you get more stress. Relax. Yeah, it was a great experience. I had this guy, he's the owner of the hotel. He's like, where are you guys having a meeting? Oh, we have a meeting in such and such a place. And the hotel guy is like, oh, that place is no good. Come to my hotel, free of charge. Oh yeah, I'm telling you, it's incredible, incredible experience. And here we are helping people, medical missionary, and one guy came to me, he's like, oh, I have a pain, arthritis pain, my knee is painful. I said, let me help you. I went to his home and then gave him candle wax treatment. You melt the candle, you put on the, it doesn't really heal, but you just put on the knees, kind of relieves the pain. And it's like, I'm putting on the wax on him. He's like, oh, caliente, right? And it's like, okay, okay. And then I'm giving the treatment. I'm telling him, okay, okay, no more smoking. No more Coca-Cola, okay? And telling him all these health tips, you know? And it was really great. But then one day, a lady came to me. She says, oh, brother Peter, can you come see my father? He's really sick. I'm like, really? What kind of sick? He's in the bed and not able to get up. Please come and help us. And I looked at her and I said, okay, let's go. But I say, okay, let's go. But in my heart, what did I just say? I'm not a doctor. I have no idea. What if this guy's in leprosy or something? I don't know. I don't want to get leprosy or some kind of disease. But I don't know. I mean, I just follow what the Bible says. You know, in the Bible, people come to Jesus. Jesus, can you come? Jesus says, okay, I'll go. I just copy. I just copy. I mean, like, okay, I'll go. And I said it in like a Jesus hero. Okay, I'll go. Let's go. But in my heart, I have no idea. God, please be with me. I have no idea what's going on here. So we went to this house. I took my student with me. My student was with me and translator. We went to this house. When we walked in, it was a poor house. Floor was still kind of dirt, you know, that hard dirt. Yeah. And then we saw this. We went into this dark room. We saw grandpa, an elderly man, lying on his bed. And we were kind of talking. And there was a Catholic lady, his wife. Catholic lady, she's like talking about in Spanish. I don't understand it. I guess she was talking about all the life problem since her birth. I have no idea, but she would just keep talking. And then we're like, what is wrong with him? He's having a hard time moving his feet. Really? Well, let's look at his feet. And then when we uncovered him, he was wearing socks. Actually. Socks, many socks, and then took the socks off, But then underneath him, there were these sticky stuff that smells like menthol or, but it was there for a long time. You can see the black sticky substance like build up. And we took that off. And when we took the whole thing off, when we looked at the feed, you don't want to see that kind of feed when you want to do foot washing service. You know how you guys are sometimes. I don't know about other churches, you guys do that or not. But in Adventist Church, they have a foot washing. And just before the foot washing, you make sure you do, you know, you wash your feet. So you go to church already all clean. You can already kiss your feet, okay? But then when I saw the feet, yikes, it's disgusting. So I'm like, okay, let's wash his feet. I say, let's wash his feet. And then I looked at my student. And my student is a Korean. And in Korean society, older, younger, older person say something, younger has to obey. So I say, and sometimes I don't even have to say it. I say, let's wash his feet. And I looked at him and I was communicating to him with my eyes. You wash his feet. And with my eyes, I'm like, it's really good for you. I am your teacher, you my student. This is a good opportunity for you. I can say all that in just one look. You know what I'm talking about, right? And the student, Korean student, he looked at me with another communication. Do I really have to? Why did I come with you? You are torturing me. You have no choice. So we got a basin of water and we put his feet in the water. As soon as his feet touched the water turned black. I mean, literally grayish black. Throw the water away. What to do? And I think we had kind of washed him twice or something. And here he is, like, touching the feet. You know, try to be so loving and joyful. Hallelujah. It doesn't work. Jesus loves me. No, it doesn't work. It's disgusting, right? So, but anyhow, we decided to do what we called a hydrotherapy. Hot and cold water treatment. Why? Because if there's any problem, at least we can help with the circulation. Because perfect circulation means perfect health. So that's what we did, hydrotherapy. Hot water, cold water, hot water. Then actually, icy water, hot, cold, hot, cold. After 20 to 25 minutes, that grandpa, he was able to stand up. And he was moving his feet. It was a miracle. Remember the Catholic woman, the wife? Talk, 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 talk. When she saw him stood up, walking, moving his feet, she... It's like God opened his leg, opened his feet, and God closed her mouth. It was a miracle, and the family were so happy. It's like, wow, gracias, you know, thank you. And I'm like, as though I did it, don't worry, it's nothing. But then, as we were walking out, as I was going back to our main campus, God was talking to me. Peter, I know what God's going to say. Peter, you do not have enough love.
You do not have enough love. Are you willing to love so that you can serve? God, forgive me. Change my heart. So rest of the way, I had a heart of repentance. Do you understand? So my question to you, if Jesus asks you, sell all that you have, meaning, are you willing to give all your heart for God's work? But then God's work is not just church building and put your, you know, picture on the church and saying, I donate that. No, that's nothing. But are you willing to do something for somebody? Until you see that person's eyes will say to you without words, thank you for spending your time with me. You touched my life. That is a result of listening to the voice of Jesus and opening the door. Ladies and gentlemen, Jesus will knock at your door with judgment. But it's not a scary judgment. It's actually an opportunity for you to experience the love of God working through you. Amen? So let me ask you something. Is there anyone here tonight that you can say, I am a selfish person. Tonight's message really touched me. I want to live a different life. I want to live a life that is a life of service. Yes, have the truth. Yes, have the Holy Spirit. But much more, I want to use God-given talents to help somebody else to know the truth, to receive the Spirit, and to accept Jesus Christ, and to go to the kingdom of God together as a big family. Would you like that? If you do, please stand with me as we have our closing prayer. Gracious, loving Heavenly Father, we thank you so much for this evening. And Lord, it is clear from the Bible that you are challenging all of us with a standard of heavenly love. We live according to our standard of love, and we think we are spiritual and religious because we do a lot of religious stuff, but yet, do we have true love in our religious activities? So Father, may we open our hearts and minds and embrace you as our Savior, not only to save us from sin, but save us from selfishness. Save us from pride. Save us from just wanting to survive and just save ourselves. So teach us to learn the joy of surrendering, sacrifice, and serve other people. So Lord, we repent of our sins. Forgive us. Change us. Transform us according to your image, that the revelation of Jesus Christ will shine clearly through us. Please be with all these people who are standing here tonight. May you give them magnificent experience as they are being touched by the love of God flowing through them in truth, in righteousness, in the Spirit of God. Thank you. Go with us. We ask in Jesus' name. Amen.